Very excited to have Paolo Serra with us today. He is one of the foremost experts on Dynamo for civil 3D, and so I'll be helping him. My name is Ben Wardell. I'm a technical marketing manager with Autodesk as well, and so I'll be helping out just a bit, but very excited to have Paolo with us. So as a matter of some formalities and upfront, want to talk a little bit about this webcast series. Generally, we have this once a month, and that's something that you can look for in emails. But the purpose of these is really to bring what some of the latest developments are in the software, some of the latest features, and oftentimes some of the things that the users are really looking for, and ways that we can present and kind of get the creators and the users together into a common format. Next month being July, a number of people are out, and so we're actually not going to be having the webinar for next month, but look for information that is going to be in regards to the upcoming presentation that will be in August. So you can look for that in emails and on some of the different sites that we've got some of this information on. As a general reminder, this broadcast, this webcast will be provided and will be posted at the Civil Community link. And the site is right there, civil-community.autodesk.com. We have any upcoming webinars are generally posted there. We've got some tips and tricks, things along those lines. But for the most part, the webcast, the previous webcasts that we've had on there, those will all be posted there. So I know we generally get quite a few questions on that. Look for the posting within the next couple of days after this webinar that'll be held there. Also, want to direct everyone's attention to our Autodesk, the AEC webinar portal. This is where you can sign up for future webcasts. You can also find some of the recordings that are available there as well. And so that's the site, theautodesk.com, AEC/webinars/infrastructure. So a lot of good information there as well. As a general disclaimer, anything that we show that is considered future or a preview, please keep in mind that's not a guaranteed promise. So please don't make any kind of purchasing decisions based on those. But those are our best estimate as far as things that are coming. And again, as was pointed out, we want to encourage everyone to ask questions. If you have questions about some of the capabilities, please ask those there. We do have a number of people who are on hand who can help out with those questions. In addition, at the end of the webinar, we will get into some of those questions that a number of people have asked as well. We will also get to a point later on, and I'll queue everyone up, but at some point we'd also be interested in some of your input on some of the potential scripts and procedures, workflows that you would like to see Dynamo do. So with that, we have a handful of poll questions that we would like to initiate, and with that I'm going to turn that over to Annie for the opportunity to present those questions now.
Yep, and so everyone should be able to see this on your screen. We'd like to get a sense of the primary civil discipline that you're involved in.
And we will let that run for just a few more seconds here. Okay, so the next question, thank you everyone who voted there. So a lot of land development, a lot of roads and highways, and a little bit of everything else. Very good. Okay, so next question up, we've got a couple of these, and we'll move through these fairly quickly. So just interested in seeing what everyone's experience is. So if you're at that, just starting out, 0 to 3, 3 to 5, 6 to 10, and then the experience ones at the bottom. So we'll let that run for the next 10 or 15 seconds, let everyone have a chance to submit their vote there. All right, we've got some experience on the line. Excellent. And a little bit of everything in between. So thank you, everyone. And so last question here for now. And so want to figure out what products you're currently using. And you can select multiples in this case. But we'll let that run for just a little bit. Interested to see who has had a chance to get into Dynamo, or what the main products that you're currently using, what those reflect. So we'll let that run for the next 15 to 20 seconds, give everyone a chance to vote on that as well. Okay, great. Hopefully everyone's here at the right place. Hopefully those of you who are using, you know, Revit Networks and Navisworks kind of using that in supplement to Civil 3D, but it looks like the majority of our users are Civil 3D users. So you are in the right place, folks. So really appreciate it. With that, I'm going to turn the time and the presentation over to Paolo. So.
Thank you, Ben. Just going to try and share my screen. Can you make a presenter, please?
You bet. I think you already are. It looks like you're already the presenter, so looks like you're good.
Can I see my screen?
Yep, okay. Very good.
Okay, so thank you everyone for having me here, and we're excited to present to you what we've done around Dynamo for Civil 3D. So a little bit of the agenda we're going to talk about today, what is computational design and what is Dynamo? And I'm working in the consulting department for Autodesk, so I would like to shed some light behind the background, what actually are my experiences directly with customers around this, and how we came about to help the team, Nigel Peter team, in creating Dynamo for Civil 3D. We're going to talk about the use cases for railroads and land development, so we have a lot of people interested in last topic, I guess, and we're going to talk about some next steps, and we're going to open up for question and answers. So without any further ado, again, some safe harbor statement again, because we can talk about some discussions, some things that are not yet in the product or available to the customers maybe, and please don't make any purchase decisions based on what you hear from here. Okay, so what is computational design? I think that you're kind of familiar with this kind of drawings. So when you think about designing, you can express the design intent using sketching. So you can create something in your mind, and then to communicate the ideas, to convey these kind of dimension and relationships, what you're doing is kind of reverse engineering. So you're expliciting the dimensions and the rules that you're trying to introduce in your design. So this is how we have always done our engineering or architectural design. So what's the new innovation that you can use within within this realm? Well, it's conceptual design that computational design, sorry, that happens based on these kind of relationships. And to explain what computational design is, kind of put together a couple of slides that I actually borrowed from my colleagues Dieter Vermeulen. So if you think about data, data is this core of what we're doing today in our profession. And computational design, what it's trying to do is to define data relationships. So for example, if you have these couple of variables A and B, then you can define a relationship A minus B equal to C. So that is going to be your function. That is the relationship that connects the two variables. Now, if instead of numbers, you're looking at these geometrical shapes, the function still makes sense. So you can define your own functions to define your custom relationships. And with that, you can express the same design intent, but you can control it with this system of rules. Now, you have traditional scripting where you're defining a sequence of instructions via text, and you can obtain different shapes in this case. And what you see on the side is a small Python script that can run inside Dynamo, for example, and produce those shapes that you see on the left. Or you can use visual programming where you're defining the sequence of instructions but using elements that are called nodes and connectors. So in Dynamo, what you see here on the right, for example, is a Dynamo graph. Instead of a Dynamo script, it's actually a graph where the visual components, these sticky notes and spaghetti that you see appearing on the screen, are defining the data flow. So the good thing about Dynamo and visual programming in general, what is different from the traditional scripting is that these relationships become dynamic, so that you can introduce even more intelligence within your model. So what is Dynamo in all this? Well, Dynamo, I try to explain what kind of tools we have at our disposal today in this kind of tree of tools that you see on the right. Well, we could start with pencil and clay or interactive tools such as Civil 3D or Revit or InfoWorks. And then as you go up in the tree, you have more sophisticated tools like the .NET framework or C++, which is the language that our engineers in Autodesk are using to create the interactive tools you're using. So where Dynamo sits in all this? Well, it's a low-hanging fruit within these tool set. And as you can see, there is a small man that is trying to reach it. So you still need to make an effort, but it's not as big as if you're trying to learn C# in one go or C++. So it allows you to do more things than what you can normally do using interactive tools, or more sophisticated things, and to be more consistent in the way you're modeling, in the way you're creating your design. And the other image that I think is really powerful when it comes to Dynamo is this Swiss Army knife, that you see on the left. Basically, every node, every sticky note that you see here on the screen is like a blade in your Swiss Army knife. And you can combine those blades and create the way that unique way that you want to prototype some kind of automation. And you can receive the benefits of these combined blades with the out-of-the-box tools that you find, but you can also create your own. And this is the very peculiar advantage of using visual programming, and in particular Dynamo here. So this is for those of you that are not really familiar with Dynamo. Well, Dynamo is kind of a prototyping environment, and it's like any Windows-based software. So you have your menus at the top, you will file new, open, save, undo, redo, and so on. But you have the library on the left that contains all the nodes that you can pick from, that you can combine in these workspace area that you see here on the right. And then you can decide to execute a specific graph, a specific combination of those nodes using the execution bar. So the execution bar has different behaviors. It could be automatic. So it's like every time you make a change to the graph, this will instantaneously translate into action, or it could be manual. So you're in full control of when and what kind of data should be executed and should be passed into the graph. So the workspace has two natures. There's a 2D nature, bidimensional nature, which is the one that contains the graphs and the nodes and the connectors, so the graphs itself. And there's also a 3D, more geometrical nature, which is kind of what you see here in the background with this grid in perspective. So the idea is that Dynamo allows you to do automation in general, but also provides you very powerful geometrical tools that you can use to you can use in when you're creating your design, when you're trying to convey some information for your particular infrastructural design, for example, for land development. So I wanted to give you a hint. How do you get started with Dynamo here? You need to focus on the data flow. You need to start to think about where these values are stored and how they flow from the left to the right of the diagram. And it's easy to follow them because they are following these connectors, these black lines that are connecting these sticky notes, these nodes. And that can be of different types. So in this case, we have numbers, but what they do is that they will trigger a function. And then the product, the output of that function can be in turn the input for another function. So what you see here is capturing a particular relationship between a point that is sitting in the origin, another point that is somewhere in space in the XY plane. Then you calculate dynamically the distance between these two points, and then you're using that value to create a circle. So what happens is that if you move one of the sliders that you see on the left, well, this circle will change the shape. And here you see very well the two natures of the of the workspace. So the 2D nature that contains the nodes and the 3D background. So this is, again, something that I wanted to talk about to show you there's nothing complicated around Dynamo, if you understand what it is. It's really a prototyping environment for you to create your own automation. Now, they could be as simple as this with geometrical entities, or they can even help you to handle big amount of data, and you can use these in your beam-based workflows. So where can you find Dynamo today? In Autodesk, we have a integration active with these products here. So Advanced Steel, Alias, Civil 3D, of course, but also Formit, Revit, and even a standalone version of Dynamo called the Sandbox. So all these are based exactly on the same kind of language, the same kind of visual programming principles. So here's another advantage for you. If you're learning Dynamo, you can apply what you're learning in other environments. So you can start to really leverage this kind of Swiss Army knife image that I was trying to refer to before. There's also the possibility to expand what you can currently do with the nodes and the visual programming with traditional scripting. So it's kind of a layer on top of the visual programming environment that allows you to access the .NET framework on the host application. So for example, you could use this to access the full Civil3D.NET API and create your own automation and create your own scripting with, again, this kind of prototyping approach. Because of Python, it's an interpreted language, allows you to make changes on the fly and test what you're doing, and without having the need to compile a tool and then reload it all the time. So this, again, is something that I would like you to point to if you want to do more with this kind of tools. So why use Dynamo then? Well, Dynamo provides you unique skills and features and capabilities that will allow you to do more. So create more complex models and to be more consistent. So doing something better than what you're already doing. And trying to apply these kind of automation principles will remove the boredom for repetitive tasks. So you will do the same, even better results with less effort on your hand. And if you want to know a little bit more about Dynamo in general, you can point to these resources here. We will share the presentation afterwards, so you'll have the links. But the one that I really recommend for especially the beginners is the dynamoprimer.com website. It's something that is generic for most of the chapters. It's like a website where you can start reading and doing exercises, and this should get you pretty far in terms of understanding how Dynamo works. There's also a lot of material already in the Autodesk University repositories, so you can go there. Unfortunately, it will be very Revit oriented mostly, but there's also some of the examples that I'm going to talk about in a minute that are starting to delve into the infrastructure space.
Paul, a quick question. We've got a question. Just want to touch on this very, very briefly, because I know we won't spend a majority of this, but if someone wants to get into and learn Python more, is there a place that you would direct them to learn more about the Python scripting?
Well, good question. Thanks, Ben. So for Python specifically, there are a lot of courses on e-learning platforms. I myself started to learn from one of them, called Lynda.com, and I can recommend that, but because I know that there are so many resources on the internet with this day and age, it's really difficult not to learn Python. You are bombarded with Python advertisement, even if you start to look into Google. So any good place to start to learn Python generically, but if the interesting part is to learn the APIs of the products. So for example, if you want to learn the Civil 3D API or the AutoCAD API, well, in that case, my first stop shop would be the ADN website, so the Autodesk Developer Network. The difficulty will be that there's no official support for Python as a language, so you don't have as many examples that are already translated into Python. But again, this is an initiative that we could take up as a community of Dynamo and Python users. So we could create something on the Civil 3D section of the Dynamo forum. We're going to talk about this later. And we can start to host a series of lessons, for example. This would be definitely something that I would like to see growing up in the interest with the user community. Okay, I hope I answered your question.
Yep, so let's get into that.
Yes, at a very high level, how do you use Dynamo on a daily basis? Well, there are three kind of workflows. And what you see here on the right, first off, is the template that I came up with in terms of color coding for the functions that you might have inside a particular automation. This is, again, very, very high level. But these colors are identifying some specific functions that you have usually in an automation, whatever language you're using. So what you can do is to use the nodes that you have in Dynamo to select objects from the model, extracting the data, the properties of this model, of these objects, and then write those values to an external file, for example, an Excel file. And this is something that you already can do, of course, in SIL3D out of the box or in Revit out of the box, for what it matters. But Dynamo gives you the flexibility of organizing this data the way you like, the way you need. And this is, again, something that could be very useful when you are trying to communicate with other teams. Then another kind of workflow is to, again, select object, read external input instead this time, and modify the objects inside the model, modify the properties. So this is where the power of Dynamo is really coming out, because you can now start to populate the object that you have in your model starting from an external source, for example, another Excel file or a CSV file. And this will make sure that these properties stay aligned, stay in sync between the two different platforms. So again, it's less effort for you, no data, manual data entry, but also a better model because they're in sync and they tell exactly the same story. The final high-level workflow is the user inputting some data, and then you create your custom functionalities, like creating your custom command for Civil 3D in a way, and then you will use it to create but also update existing objects. And this is where the power of Dynamo really comes out, because you can use your tool of choice, for example Civil 3D, and start to expand on specific workflows that are impacting your delivery. So you can start to create functionalities today that are not yet in the product. So this is the experience that we had with consulting. So I developed a tool that is called Civil Connection. It's actually a couple of tools, Civil Connection and Civil Python. And these are Dynamo packages, but for Dynamo for Revit. And what they do is trying to read the data out of SIL3D and use it to drive the creation of Revit elements, and also read the data out of Revit and create the same elements and link them inside SIL3D. Now, the tool is not the first attempt that someone tried to do to connect the two environments, but it's now open source, it's fully customizable, you can find it on the package manager for Dynamo. And the most important thing is that was kind of the proof that we have some space for visual programming in linear structures and infrastructure in general. So these kind of experience with consulting led to have multiple use cases and reaching out to different set of customers. And with the help of Nigel's team, we were able to put together a prototype very quickly and to show these to the internal stakeholders on the SEAL3D Futures portal and finally release it in a matter of 8 months. So very quickly, based on this experience and trying to focus specifically on alignments and transportation kind of workflows. But Dynamo for Civil 3D is something that you can download today if you haven't done so. You can download it from your Autodesk account, from manage.autodesk.com. You can find it as a separate installer at the moment. You will have to download it for Civil 3D 2020. And it will be available to you under the Manage tab once you have installed it. So it comes with two icons. One is the full-fledged Dynamo with the user interface, and the other one is a headless mode called Run Script. As I mentioned before, the focus with this release is around transportation workflows, and it contains 9 sample workflows and 1 .NET API sample. Now, what you will find in here is probably not exactly what you need, but again, these are covering pretty generic workflows, and they're just a couple of tweaks away from what you need. So it should get you going with visual programming. What I encourage you to do since now is to go and reach out to the Civil 3D section of the Dynamo community forum and start to post questions and reach out for people that have more experience than you might have at this moment in time around the computational design concepts or Dynamo as a language, and then just ask your question. We have a very active community, and I'm sure that this will benefit the most of you. So what can you find? So there's a question?
Real quick, Paolo, a couple of questions came in. Just want to, and this just for clarification, should be quick. So Dynamo for Civil 3D is available in Civil 3D 2020 only, correct? A few questions asking if it's available in 2019 or previous versions. I believe it's for 2020 only, correct?
That's correct.
Okay.
And as far as I know, there are no plans for making it available for earlier versions. But again, if you're interested and you have access to a Revit license for many of the Civil 3D workflows that we're going to see today, you can leverage the Civic connection. And this will work with versions from 2017 to 2019.
Okay, very good.
So what can you find inside Dynamo for Civil 3D? You will have actually two dedicated shelves in the library. So the first one that you see here is Dynamo for AutoCAD, and the second one is Dynamo for Civil 3D. So I'm using these two different colors. So the red ones are for the AutoCAD dedicated nodes. Again, what you see here, they are not exactly the nodes, but they're more the objects, the entities that you can expect to find. So at the moment, you can access the current, the active document, and you can access all these spaces, all these blocks, so as they are called in the API. So you can access the layers, the model space, where you are adding most of your design, the paper space, where you have your drawings, and the line types. Then in terms of selection, you have these basically three options. You can either select the objects by layer, or you can select them directly, so select object, or you can filter the elements by their type. So for example, you can select straight away only the lines or only the corridors, only the alignments and so on. On the right hand side of this slide, you will see the object model. So the elements that you can currently, let's say, interact with in different degrees, and also those that are coming. At least this is the plan. There are many more to come. And I'm not going to touch upon what's coming in more detail, but all the elements that you see here, you will be able to at least interact with them in a reading capacity. And for some of them, you can even expect to have some creation, creation methods. So you can create from the Dynamo environment into the AutoCAD environment. In Civil 3D terms, instead, using the same AutoCAD document, the same DWG basically, you can access through some shortcuts, if you will, selection shortcuts to the alignments present in the model and the corridors. And when it comes to corridors, there are already some objects that you can interact with, such as the baseline regions, the corridor feature lines, and the applied subassemblies and their parameters. So what it means is that now through Dynamo, you can override, for example, the subassembly parameters that you have in a corridor. So you can be very, very precise when you're making these edits. And you can do this, for example, reading the data from an external source, like an Excel file, or vice versa. You can create an Excel file that represents the state of the subassembly parameters, exporting their values to this spreadsheet. Again, what is coming next is probably something that you already know if you're following the Civil 3D Futures portal. There's a section dedicated to Dynamo for Civil 3D, and the team has been working nonstop in trying to implement new features and expand the workflows around these linear objects first, with surfaces, cocal points, and feature lines, for example, and also something that is really near and dear to my heart, property sets, to put more information and being able to control all the information workflow related to Civil 3D specifically. Now, if you don't find something that suits your purpose, you are still you can still expand what you can do today if you're reaching out for a package on the Dynamo Package Manager, or if you know how to code in Python and you have some degree of knowledge of the .NET API of AutoCAD and Civil 3D, you can create your own script interacting directly with the .NET API, or you can even create your own custom nodes. So to have the same look and feel of a out-of-the-box Dynamo node. And for that particular example, I recommend you to go and read the API samples that are shipped with Dynamo for Civil 3D. So with these, I'm going to start to talk about use cases that between Ben and myself put together to present to you some real world scenarios in these different industries. So we'll start with rail. And with rail, we're going to talk about something that is really difficult to do in Civil 3D out of the box, namely modeling the discrete elements, such as the concrete ties that you see here in blue, or these masts, so the poles that are supporting the cables. So the cables themselves, also something that is really difficult to do because we don't have this kind of control in the product just yet. But this is all possible today with Dynamo. So the goal here is to show you an overview of how this is possible with Dynamo. And we have a video I'm gonna try and play. And if you want, afterwards, we can even see these diagrams live, so we can explore them. So as you can see on the left, I have the shelf. At the top, I have the AutoCAD and Civil 3D libraries. I can combine my nodes in a way that I can use to create a concrete tie, so placing these block references. I can read from an external CSV file and use it to place other block references, but in a way that is following an alignment again, not exactly on the center. And then I can use a more sophisticated Dynamo graph to create these cables and with the necessary detail here. This is the final results that Ben put together. And I have to thank also my colleague in consulting, Quentin, for providing this kind of very detailed block references. So if you have any questions, please just talk me here. If you have any specific burning questions on rail, and if you would like to see more in detail the Dynamo graph, I would like to ask you to just postpone it afterwards when we're going to do the Q&A session. So when it comes to roads, again, we have something similar in terms of degree of difficulty. So we have discrete elements such as the lighting posts or the signals, but also something that is, let's say, has two natures. So it's discrete and also continuous, such as the barriers here. So we have the discrete component, which are the posts, and there are block references. But then we have also these continuous faces for the barriers that are following the road somehow, but they're not exactly following, for example, the same frequency of the corridor. They, of course, have to be related to that, but they're not exactly following the same frequency. They are actually following the frequency of the posts. So now I hope that you can see this kind of connection. So you need to identify what you're trying to achieve, what are the components involved in this automation, and what's the sequence to create them in the model. And you need to focus on these dynamic relationships from the input data that you're receiving, in this case, a feature line on the edge of the road with a specific baseline region, for example, and the final output, which is a combination of these block references and the face. So the face in particular is generated as a Dynamo solid and is sent straight directly into Civil 3D. So here's another video that hopefully explains that more in detail. So again, we have this particular example showing you how you can create discrete elements like counterfold walls. And the good thing here is that you can create this dynamic relationship so that the counterfold wall will adapt itself, the height following the feature lines. So we saw to create the final result here, and you can see they are following nicely on the road. And this is again possible through Dynamo, so that if you're making any changes to the input, these output will update for you. So this is something that is very difficult to achieve with traditional programming. So in terms of site development instead, we have again three use cases. The first one is on ramps. So I'm pretty sure that this is a very common workflow for you, and John Syrer helped out a lot here identifying what is of interest for a site developer. And with these Dynamo functionalities, there's no Python coding involved whatsoever. It's all pure Dynamo nodes and geometry gymnastics, if you will. Now you have a tool that is ready for you to create this kind of ramps today. And you can use it to create line work. You can use this line work to create a surface. And then if you're happy with the surface, you're done. Otherwise, as Ben has done here, you can convert the surface into a solid and use it to carve the solids out of the corridor. This is not the only way of doing it. Of course, you can even change the subassembly parameters and basically obtain the same kind of result. The good news is that you are free to choose whatever method you prefer. So if you're in control of the subassemblies, no questions, then you can go and modify the subassembly parameters. If you don't own that kind of data, that particular information is not inside your basket per se, well, then you can still achieve what you're trying to do here, and you can create this detailed design using Dynamo. The other example that we will see is related to point labeling report. It's not here in this slide yet, but what if I need to create point label point in the drawing? Actually, I should say in the model, and these points are not exactly on top of the feature line, and maybe they even have a different frequency. For a general contractor to have an understanding how much it's going to cost and how difficult it's going to be to create such road. Well, with Dynamo, turns out it's pretty easy to either do the points and visualize them inside the model, and also extract this data in a tabular format so that you can consume it in a different way. You don't even have to have Civil 3D to understand how to place it, how to create these objects. And finally, the last example that we're going to see here for site development is how do we start from a 2D linear scheme of a sewage network, and how do we create COGO points that are related to the sewage, but also to the parcel, to the what you see here, for example, property 36 or property 37. And how do we make sure that these COGO points are actually sitting on the existing ground surface? So this particular example is something that is not addressed straight away within Dynamo today, but I've developed a very simple Python code to do exactly that. So if you're in need of something that is not in Dynamo, you have several options at your disposal, and you can pick the one that is more suitable to you. So here again, another video to show the whole workflows. Okay, so you can launch Dynamo. You can define different inputs, for example, in this case, to specify the stations where you want these ramps to be. And hit and run, this will create the line works for you. So in this case, you have two different types of ramps. You have the ramps with wings or the kind of square ramps, the rectangular shape ramps. This is another way of consuming data inside Dynamo, starting from an Excel file to do all these ramps in one go. And this is producing exactly the same result with the benefit that you can control it via an external source. So you don't have to be a Dynamo geek to create the ramps anymore. You can now create this curve report. So you have full control of the headers. You can create these points along the corridor, along the road, and then create exactly the same report in Excel. So you can find, for example, point 107 with the station east and north in an elevation. Now, these are the 2D lines, and this is the Python code that I put together. Really simple. Only 100 lines of code, and most of it is boilerplate code. And what you can see here in the background is those points sitting inside these parcels boundaries. And I'm using specifically the Dynamo engine for containment tests. So the Dynamo geometry engine, sorry. And I'm identifying these points and projecting them on the existing ground using the Civil 3D.NET API and creating the COBOL points. Now the COBOL points node will probably be there in the next release of Dynamo, but and so let's say this will simplify a little bit this workflow, but for the parcels, we may need to have to wait a little bit. So there's also another initiative that I'd like to talk about, which is this Civil 3D toolkit that we're planning to do with other Autodeskers. So we really care about you. We are a customer company, but it's not a joke. We really do care about you. And what we want to do is to enable all the users to benefit from the technology. And we would like to connect you with pockets of value. So what we're trying to do is to define an internal set of nodes that are that will be available to you one day. I don't release any plan here, but the intention is to create these set of tools to enable more site development or land development workflows, for example, on pipe networks, for example, exchanging data with BIM 360 for coordination and review. So all of these is possible today, it's just not in the product yet, but this will not stop us from reaching out to you and giving you the right tools to do your job.
And one point I also want to make, Paolo, and yeah, right now the screen is blanking, that's fine, we've got some questions on that. The question in regards to some of those videos, the way that they showed were a little bit kind of herky-jerky when they come across. You can get to those same videos. We posted all those on YouTube. And if you go to YouTube and search under Dynamo Civil 3D, we've linked all the videos. There's some how-to videos, but also you'll see some of those videos up there. They're very similar as well, and so you can kind of watch those and get a better feel for how those work as well. So YouTube, just search under again Dynamo for Civil 3D. So just want to make that point as well on some of those.
Hey Ben, there's also been some questions about whether we can give access to these scripts. Is there a plan to maybe make those available?
I think we can.
I think we can, because none of the information that we've shown in those videos was developed by us. There weren't any kind of proprietary design elements or anything that was owned by somebody else. And so those were scripts that we worked on and that we developed. So those are things that we can make available. And Paul, maybe later on we can kind of talk about where that kind of information can be posted and made available as well.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Okay, so with this, I'd like to ask you to work with us. So in some action items, please go and download and install Dynamo for SEAL 3 from your Autodesk account. Visit the SEAL 3 Fusers portal to be in touch with the latest version and possibly provide feedback for the development team. And please visit the Dynamo SEAL 3D forum that you can find at this link here. There's a new, brand new section dedicated to the questions specifically for Dynamo for SEAL 3D. And start exploring the use cases shipped with the product and start automating your workflows. So with this, we're gonna have another quick poll. So I can stop sharing my screen.
Okay. And I know he covered a lot of ground quickly, but I just want to see, do you see a use for this? We're interested to get some information from all of you to see, is this something that you feel like you could use? And granted, in an hour time frame, it's not probably ideal to show you the full capabilities of it, but kind of giving you a sampling of what it's capable of. And we'll cover more of this a little bit later on as well, but just want to see if this is something you guys are interested in using. So we'll let that run for another 5 seconds or so. Okay, great. So hopefully for the maybes and likelies, it'll just be a matter of being able to figure out the best way to use it and how it's going to fit into your particular workflows. So one more question, and this is just in regards to if you're interested in finding out a little bit more about this. And so this is just if you want to speak with somebody about Autodesk, about getting up to speed with Dynamo for Civil 3D. So we'll let this run for 10 or 15 seconds here or so. And while we're waiting on that, we have a fantastic questions submitted all across the board. Really appreciate the input from everybody. A lot of really great questions, a lot of really good direction with this. You guys are thinking about this in the right way, that you know the possibilities are there. So we'll go ahead and end that poll right now. But right now we'd like to ask everyone to kind of pause for just a second. And in the chat window, so underneath where you see the questions, where the questions can be submitted, we are really interested in getting some input from all of you in regards to some data sets or workflows that you would be interested in seeing in the future. So under the chat, if you can say submit to either the entire audience or to organizers, you're welcome to post those. But under those chat windows, really are interested in finding out what kind of data sets all of you would like to see. What kind of workflows or scripts that we can create and even make available to you on some of these sites as well. So for now until the rest of the until the rest of the webinar, you're welcome to under the chat menu. We just want to be able to sort those out. But that would be great to get some more input from you, some common tasks that you're working on from day to day, and what would be most useful for you. So
hey Ben, there are a lot of folks actually adding them in the questions area.
And we figured that'd be the case, but what we will do is we'll take a look at those. So seeing a lot of good information, a lot of utility information, a lot of property sets, those are coming, good information on all of that. So with that, we will try and dive in to get into some of these questions that a number of you have posted, in some cases, I think Paolo was kind of the best person to ask on some of those. So Paolo, I'm going to start at the top. So some of these might be a little bit older as far as earlier on in the webinar, but we'll go ahead and go through some of these. So question about Python scripting, he's getting an error. Maybe that's something we can reach out to that one individually. But he wants to see, is there a way to break out data in a Python script into individual outputs?
Okay, well, at the moment, no. The only thing you can do is use a code block afterwards, and then select the list of outputs that you're getting out of the Python script, and then break them outside the Python script.
Okay, very good. Okay, some of the other questions, you talked a little bit about the civil connection. Some people are interested in getting a copy of the civil connection, the importer exporter for Revit, And that's available. That's just available through the package manager, correct?
So on the package manager, you will find it for Civil 3D and Revit 2020. And if you go and look for the GitHub, Autodesk.com Civil Connection, you will find it for version 2017 to 2020, including the Civil Python tool. And I just happened to release version 3 a few days ago.
Okay, very good. Okay, trying to respond to some of the questions that were submitted as well, but let's get into some of these others, okay? Okay, so researching the possibility of extracting data from Civil 3D cross-sections, looking at corridors, recommendations, is that something that's possible by utilizing or extracting information from Civil 3D cross-sections?
Is that
supported yet at this point?
Yes, in a way, okay, well, it depends on what kind of information you want, but if you're looking at the applied assemblies, for example, applied subassemblies, well, then yes, you can extract that kind of information with the version the year is currently available today. And again, if there's something specific that you're interested in, we can discuss this or even either now. Offline. Yes.
Okay. So we do have some requests to see some of the scripting for the cables. And Paolo, I think at this time I'll take over and present some of that, if that's okay. So let me know if you can see my screen.
I can.
Okay. So I'm going to bring up. This is the data set that Paolo and I worked on. And when I say and I was really just kind of, you know, bouncing ideas off of Paolo. He did the lion's share of the lifting. I just want to make that clear right now. So what we have is a rail model here. And what we used were these 3D blocks to place ties or sleepers. We used the CSV files to place these overhead catenary, these poles. And then we kind of threw the idea around and said, you know what, it'd be really great if we could come up with a way to display the wires. So by launching Dynamo here, I'll try and bring up the script that Paolo put together. And Paolo, I don't know if you want to just kind of talk about the script here. Let me bring this up real quick right here.
Yes. So while you're doing that, we also prepare a simplified version of the diagrams of these graphs.
Yes. And so let me find those as well.
Could be overwhelmed for someone that opens Dynamo for the first time.
Okay. So let me do that first.
Great. Thanks. So what we are using here is a language called BPMN. It stands for Business Process Modeling Notation. It's a standard, and it's again kind of visual programming. So what I've try and do with this particular approach is to use these names that you see here in these rectangular boxes. These are called the tasks. And I've been using the same name inside the Dynamo file as node groups. So for example, if we go back and forth between the two, then you can show that you have the same node groups. So if you zoom out a little, mm-hmm. Yeah, so you start to the very left, like reading a book. You have the inputs, of course. So it's like your start here. And then you have another node called, for example, a node group, if you pan it to a little bit across the top. That's called get poll station from CSV. So that's kind of the same principle. You have a macro collection of nodes that goes under what is called a node group. And these nodes are connected all together, and they will perform this high-level task that you see in the diagram, the Y diagrams that we were looking at before. Okay. So from here, what do? You're reading an input that is coming from the top here, the CSV file, and you get the poles or the mast stations. So the position of these poles along the alignment. And you're reading this from the CSV file. Then we'll calculate an object in Dynamo that is called a coordinate system, which is basically an origin with three mutually orthogonal vectors. And coordinate systems in Dynamo are used to describe space. And what you can do with that is an operation that is called transformation. So you can transform a piece of geometry from a point in space to, let's say, a different set of coordinates. And this is how all these, let's say, these workflows that we put together work under the hood. We always have to deal with this kind of transformation in the coordinate systems. In Dynamo for Civil 3D, you have a very specific node that will create coordinate systems for you along the baseline. So if you have the combination of the alignment and profile, you get this baseline. And the baseline contains all the same information as the alignment plus the vertical profile so that you can create a coordinate system that is always pointing upwards like the global z-axis vector. And it's oriented as the alignment, okay? So there's no grading in this case. It's something that is following a 3D polyline, per se, is a 3D line, 3D curve, but it's always pointing upwards, so it's always vertical. Now, after that, these coordinate system along the baseline are used to displace some points that will represent the poles, so the origin of these poles. And because the coordinate systems are made of three vectors and a point, we can also take into account the orientation. So that's why it's very easy using Dynamo for Civil 3D to place a block reference, but also make it so that it's following the baseline in this case. So the positioning of these objects is defined inside the CSV file. In the CSV file, if you open it, you will see that there's a name, so like defining the type of pole, so it could be centered or on the left or on the right. And then you have a station value and an offset value from the baseline. So it's difficult if I have to find the coordinates in the, let's say, north and east and elevation of each one of these poles. But it's very easy to describe them with, let's say, keeping as a reference the alignment, because I know—
Right, because these values in here are just showed as the station value, and this is the offset value, left being a negative value, right being a positive value. And so, and then if we go and update this file as well and rerun the script, it updates for us. Correct.
That's correct.
Okay. I apologize. We are getting really short on time, and we've got a lot of requests to see and talk a little bit more about the ADA ramps. So I'm going to close this right now. I'm going to close this file as well. But we'll get into this this subdivision file. So some of the questions around this this particular workflow here were in regards to grading and into these ADA ramps. And so, Paolo, maybe you can talk a little bit about this, but as far as these were 3D lines that were created by Dynamo that we can then bring in as a hide and as break lines into our corridor surface, and then the grading is in our surface model from there. We actually tested that, something that John and I tested to make sure that this is something that was a usable workflow. And the basis for that, just like Paolo talked about, in a three-dimensional, you know, space, these lines are all based on the flow line of our curb and gutter. And so they're not just arbitrarily drawn in 2D. These are actually, they have elevations that are associated with our corridor. And when we create these, we can make these part of our surface as well. So I don't know if we want to talk a little more about that, or if you want me to bring up that diagram for these ramps as well.
Maybe the diagram is easier to understand.
Okay, yeah, let me do that. I'll bring that here real quick. Okay.
So the logic behind it is not that complicated at all. So in here you have, again, you can input the ramp dimensions, so width, depth, and slope, so you can use it to do your design, and you get the corridor feature lines with the node that are nodes that are out of the box in Dynamo for Civil 3D. And then we have a couple of different options. You can either input the remaining inputs, like the station values within the Dynamo graph, or reading it from an Excel file. That's the same thing. And you can control where they are along the alignment, so the station. You can decide the side, if it's on the left or on the right. And then you can decide how to flip the ramp. It could be that you have a ramp that, depending on the orientation, can fall inside the road rather than on the sidewalk. So you can control this better.
And I just want to point out that the ramps that were created, they don't change like the corridor solid or the corridor itself, but they can be implemented into the surface that's created from the corridor. So there's some questions about that.
Yes, correct. So after that is really a matter of creating, again, a coordinate system, calculate the points, create the ramp lines, and send the line work to SUL3D.
Okay. And do you want me to bring up the script? We are over time. So really appreciate everyone who has submitted questions. And I do apologize. We weren't able to get to most of the questions. We want to make this information available. And I think that's one of the main questions that a lot of people have had is how can they get to this information? How can they get access to that? So do you have anything that you want to display again on that, Paolo? I can change it, turn it back over to you if you do.
Well, yes. So we have, again, the main point of contact here, the SUL3D Fusos portal and the Dynamo SUL3D forum. There is. Can you see on screen?
Yes.
So these are the main two places where to ask for information and leverage the community.
And is it possible for us to make those the scripts, especially the scripts that you put together for the land development, for the rail and for the road, can we make those scripts available at this forum location?
Yes, we can definitely do that.
Okay, great. That's something that we will work on within the next few days. We do have a record of the questions that were submitted. So really, really do appreciate everybody for your submitting of different workflows and types of scripts that we can put together. That's something we'll definitely look at and work with as well. Paolo, anything else to conclude on? We're over time. And again, thank you to everyone who stuck around and has looked through this. Do again want to encourage everybody that, you know, on both on this site and then on YouTube, there are some references and some resources available for getting started. But anyway, anything you want to end on as well, Paolo?
Well, even the longest march starts with the first step. This is the best advice I received when I was looking at Dynamo for the first time, and it pays off.
Yep. And just want to let everybody know who's listening or who's still on. A lot of good input and questions regarding land development. A lot of really good questions and requests for pipes and pressure networks. And so that's something that we'll take a look at and hopefully make some more information available on that coming up as well. But with that, we'll go ahead and wrap up. We want to make this webinar available to you guys on the civil community site and as well as the AEC forum site. Look for some more of this information. We've got a lot of work to do to get some of it posted, but that's where we can hopefully get some of this stuff posted so you can get this into your hands and get going and work on some of these workflows for yourself. Paolo, thank you for your time. Appreciate it. Very informative. Appreciate everybody who's staying on, and everyone, hopefully you have a great day.
Thank you for having me. Bye.